Hey guys, Jake with 8020 Media here. Today we are wrapping up our Duramax series. So today we're talking about the Duramax LMM. The LMM came in 2007.5 as a replacement for the LBZ because of, well, of course, because of tightening emissions regulations coming out of the EPA at the time. So the LMM got GM's first attempt at a DPF system and active regeneration. And I say first attempt because there were a number of problems with it, of course, that we'll go ahead and get into later. But outside of the new DPF system, the LMM is virtually the same engine as the LBZ. And the good news is, if you watched our video on the LBZ is extremely reliable as well as very tuner friendly. Unfortunately, only about half of that is true for the LMM because while it did get better heads, better injectors, and a bigger EGR cooler, it got stuck with the same exact pistons that the LBZ had. And the LBZ's pistons are known to crack around the 600 to 650 wheel horsepower range, and the same is true for the LMM. So while we do have, again, a very reliable engine, albeit with the addition of some problematic emissions equipment, we have an engine that's no more tuner friendly and can't handle any more power than the LBZ can. And so generally speaking, this isn't quite as desirable of an engine compared to the LBZ because it's basically an LBZ, only with emissions equipment that most people don't want. With that being said, let's go ahead and jump into the problems with the LMM. The first one at the top of our list is, of course, issues with the DPF system. Now, any DPF system, even in the newer modern diesels, is prone to clogging, but the LMM had some unique issues with their regeneration cycles. It was prone to having issues with excessive regeneration, and that aided to issues in the DPF clogging and the DPF failing. If you own one of these, it's extremely important to be cautious of the regen cycles and not to interrupt them, because interrupting the regen cycles is what causes a lot of problem with excessive cycling and ultimately leads to a lot of problems with the DPF system itself. Now, you can improve the reliability of it a bit just by sticking to those regen cycles, being very diligent about them and not disrupting them. But at the same time, this is a DPF system, and at one point or another, it's probably going to clog up and fail. The downside to this is that a replacement DPF system is going to run you somewhere near $2,000. It's not the most cost-friendly problem to have. The second problem with the LMM is exactly the same as the LBZ, and it's with the transmission cooling lines. There is a design flaw that takes place at what's called the crimp on the transmission cooler line, and that causes transmission coolant to leak at that crimp. So on the LMM, you're typically going to see leaking transmission lines about every 30 to 40,000 miles with the OEM lines on there. So it's very common, very popular to go ahead and upgrade those lines to get rid of the issue that comes with the design flaw on the OEM transmission cooler lines. Fortunately, this isn't the worst problem to have, but it is something that it's a little bit frustrating that was occurring on the LBZ and wasn't fixed for the LMM. Now, the third problem is with the EGR cooler. Again, another emission system. While the LBZ didn't really have these problems, the LMM got a larger EGR cooler, and while it's really not that problematic, when you do tend to get to higher mileage, it is common to run into issues with it cracking and leaking coolant, as well as with it getting clogged up from all of the diesel soot that's being passed back through it in the form of the dirty exhaust gas. The good news with the EGR cooler is that they're actually a bit more affordable than something like the DPF system. You can find a cheap replacement for a couple $100s, and you can find high quality ones for as little as $500. And so while again, it is another annoying emissions related problem, it's not the worst from a cost standpoint. And again, it's not something you're usually going to experience at a low mileage. It's really just once you get into that upper 100s and 200 plus thousand mile mark that you're going to start seeing this become more of a problem. So those three problems are really the only problems with this engine when it's in stock form. The next problems that we're going to talk about are really only things to take into consideration when you're trying to rip up the boost and crank up the power on the LMM. The first one being piston failure. Like we mentioned, the LBZ had these issues. It was known to have weak pistons, and those pistons were transferred directly over to the LMM, so it also has issues with the pistons cracking. GM did change one thing from a design standpoint that had an impact on the pistons. And so the LBZ used a 7-hole injector system, and the LMM switched to a 6-hole system. The issue with this is the 6-hole system, where two of those holes are, they sit right above the wrist pin of the pistons. So fuel's injected right around the wrist pin area of the pistons, which increases heat at the wrist pin. And the wrist pin is the weakest part of the piston and is what typically causes failure with the pistons. So the LMM is just as power capable as the LBZ. However, in my opinion, the likelihood of pistons cracking is slightly higher on the LMM when you're around that 600 to 650 wheel horsepower range. One other thing to consider is that we've seen pistons crack anywhere from 500 wheel horsepower and above. That's one thing to be cautious of if you're looking to make a good amount of power out of the LMM, but you can get pretty close to 500 with a number of bolt-on mods and get a pretty good pickup in power and performance without pushing the LMM into a power range where you're going to sacrifice a lot of reliability. Going off of that, the last thing is the transmission limitation. The Allison 1000 did get strengthened a good bit over the one that was used in the previous generation. However, it can still only handle about 500 wheel horsepower before it needs to be built, and about 450 wheel horsepower is where you're going to want to look into transmission tuning for it. A couple basic bolt-on modifications and a tuner, and you might want to look into strengthening the transmission with transmission tuning, just because these Allison 1000s on any Duramax just don't handle additional power that well. A few other things to touch on. There have been some instances with the fuel pump and the fuel injectors on very high mileage LMMs, most frequently seen on ones that tow very heavily, typically fifth wheels that tow 15 plus thousand pounds. This generally only happens on the high mileage ones, but there have been a number of problems with the engine's losing fuel rail pressure because of the injectors or because of a weak fuel pump. Again, that's really only something that occurs at very high mileage, which at that point becomes a maintenance item. At the end of the day, this is actually a really reliable engine. So really the only problems with the LMM are with the emission system. We're not going to tell you to delete them, but if you do, that makes for an extremely reliable engine, and you're going to be seeing reliability levels that are virtually similar to, if not better than, the LBZ, so long as you're not throwing a crazy amount of power at the engine. It's not the most tuner-friendly engine, but again, so long as you keep it within a reasonable power range, you're not going to be taking any significant hit to reliability. To boil everything down to a one-line description on reliability, we have an extremely reliable engine with a couple unreliable emissions components. That covers it for our video on the Duramax LMM. If you appreciated this content, go ahead, hit that like button, subscribe to the channel, and stay tuned for our future Duramax content.